everyone. We welcome you for the second IDP virtual episode of USA Insight series. I'm Yukti Jaswal, Senior Manager, US Client Relations at IDP Education. IDP Education is the world's leading student placement company and proud co-owners of us. We have a very special guest, Matt Lopez, Associate Vice President, Enrollment Services and Executive Director, Admission Services at Arizona State University. His higher education experience spans more than 20 years, giving him the breadth and the depth of experience and leadership needed for today's challenges in higher education. Prior to ASU, he served as Director of Admission at the University of Utah, as well as various admission and financial aid roles at the University of Colorado Boulder. Matt has developed and implemented underrepresented student recruitment and access initiative domestic and international recruitment strategies, as well as helped launch University of Utah Asia campus in South Korea. His academic work was done at the University of Colorado Boulder, BA Molecular and Developmental Biology, and University of Colorado Denver, Masters in Public Affairs. He presently serves as a past president for the Association of Chief Admission Officer of Public Universities. And now, the host for today is Ms. Dharma Naik, Associate Director, U.S. Dharma oversees the strategy, training, and growth of U.S. destination and U.S. team in her region. Dharma is an expat with more than 19 years of professional experience in education affairs, admission, nonprofit leadership training, and international education in the US, Europe, Asia, and South Asia. She was born and raised in UK and then shifted to the US with her family. She has completed her bachelor's in sociology with a certificate in Asian studies, followed by master's in counseling and personal services, and graduate certificate in leadership management from the University of Maryland College Park. I welcome you, Matt and Dharma. And Dharma, it is over to you now. Thank you.
Thank you, Yukti, so much for that gracious introduction of both of us. And again, from my side, a very warm welcome to you, Matt, all the way from Arizona to Gurgaon. And so, Matt, if we may, could you tell our audience a little bit about yourself? So what is something unique and exciting about your role at ASU, at Arizona State University?
Yeah, well, good evening. First and foremost, thank you very much, and a warm, gracious welcome and thank you from Arizona State University. It's a pleasure being here. You know, I have the greatest job in the world, I personally believe. And that is simple. It's to connect students, which span world regions, countries, age, creed, gender, and provide exposure to education. You know, I think, especially in our challenging times, currently, the only way that we can overcome this in a very quick manner is through education and, you know, collaboration and leadership. And so I'm at the forefront of that. What's better than being able to explain the wonders of an incredible university, the expectations and our goals and our aspirations, and then connect the right students to our universities and beyond, whether that's career afterwards to OPT opportunities, et cetera.
Thank you so much, Matt. We can definitely tell how much you love what you do, which is wonderful. So Matt, if we talk about our students and their parents who would be listening in today, often a tough decision for them is how do they decide which is the right university for them? So what might you say to them? And coupled with that, what is your vision for Arizona State University? So as a university, you're there, you're trying to recruit students also. So what do you think are some things that they should be looking out for in selecting the right university for them?
Yeah, it's a daunting task. You know, it, just in the United States alone, there are over 3,000 and more universities, right? And so having to research and find the right fit, you know, across the, from the other side of the world is challenging. And so, and again, that's why I'm so excited about my role is we look at this differently. And in fact, part of the reason why Arizona State University is not only an incredible place for students, which we'll explain, it's an incredible place to work for staff and faculty. I mean, and the vision is very clear, and it's to revolutionize how university recruitment and admission practices should change, that ultimately enable access and student success, right? And so, whereas I've worked, as you've heard, for other universities, one of the major differences with ASU is that is the expectation. I'm not expected to come in and just bring a great class, bring great students, continue to be the number one or number two public school in the number of international students. But I'm expected to change how we do things, to illuminate the opportunities that students have, to understand how education can, overcome some of humanity's greatest challenges. And so as you are looking at the landscape of opportunity, really the best things to do is try to form, if you can, and it's different, it's difficult distantly, try to get that feeling of what it means to be a member of that community. So that's through construction of relationships, that's through, listening to how the president speaks and the vision to what they're trying to do, to, seeing the type of partnerships that the university has with even, you know, in-country type universities and corporations and things like that. Hear from, you know, senior leadership like myself in regards to how we're approaching education delivery. Try and get a sense, is the university set in tradition, or are they willing to modernize and think differently and utilize new technologies and utilize new educational delivery mechanisms that benefit the student? Do they truly believe in student success? And more importantly, what is the definition to student success? You know, to me, having a student leave with a degree, whether it's a bachelor's or a master's or a doctoral degree or whatever it may be, is only one aspect of student success. It's about how involved they were. What type of opportunity did they take advantage of? Did we give the students opportunities to take advantage? Did we allow them to have corporate partnerships? Were they successful in finding jobs? Were they successful in finding jobs in the field that they study? Were they able to build a social network? Did they leave with this passion to serve? That's, at a place like ASU, that is the definition of success. You know, ASU is an incredibly unique place. We do things very differently. You may have heard that we've been ranked as the number one university for innovation 5 years in a row. And in a couple of weeks, you know, we hope that it'll be the sixth year in a row. And you know, I can explain what innovation means, but really what it comes down to, it's the type of mentality that we have that our everyone from students to faculty to staff believe in the same charter and mission and objective, and that's to educate and give students the best possible opportunity for them to be successful. And that's really what it comes down to.
Thank you for that, Matt. And I think one word that you used right now, innovation, is also really true for the US as a whole. Yeah, so my next question for you was that, you know, when we talk about the USA, in your experience working with international students, what has made the US a destination of choice for international students, and perhaps especially those from South Asia?
Yeah, you know, I think at least our university systems and the origins of that are probably one of America's greatest strengths, right? Not only in the approach to education, interdisciplinary nature, we in the United States, we use the term a liberal arts education, and what that means is that is an engineering student still needs to know how to write and still needs to know how to communicate. Now, the American education does have some tradition and history, and there are a lot of things that we think we need to do better. And that's the biggest difference about ASU is we don't sit back and find comfort in our name and our brand. We find comfort in the fact that everyone here is hungry to be better every day, whether that's faculty members who certainly want to be better at involving students in their research opportunities, who want to find maybe technology enhancements that allow for better delivery of education, so all students are able to maybe find different way. Not everybody learns the same way, right? And so can we deliver things in different ways that everybody's able to find a way and a path? Is that right now, online education is not necessarily considered to be quality in India, right? However, what if COVID and the coronavirus have done is they've shifted the what's normal, right? And people are quickly going, oh, wait, maybe online has a purpose. And maybe we need to look into this. Well, ASU's been doing online education for years, and we're looked upon as the best. And one of the differences of ASU's educational system is our online students have the exact same faculty, premier faculty, some of the best researchers and scholars in the world teaching our in-person or what we call campus immersion classes and online. Whereas a lot of other online schools will use maybe associate professors, assistant professors, not career professors. And so we look at all of this, and we've been able to scale. You know, we have ambitions to have 200,000 students in a very short time. And we know that to be able to do that, we're going to have to grow and be better and use technology and utilize the strengths of our entire campus community.
Yeah, thank you for that, Matt. Definitely a lot of great reasons for students to, you know, choose the U.S. As a study destination. Now, having said that, as you may be aware, things have been very exciting and interesting as far as news is concerned from the U.S. And now, you know, with the current situation with the revised SEVP guidelines and also the recent executive order signed by President Trump, you know, there's confusion among students and parents. And, you know, it's causing a lot of worry in terms of what does it mean for them in terms of applying to a U.S. university? Will they be able to come? You know, should they wait? Should they defer? So what would you say to the students who are worried right now in terms of taking those next steps?
Yeah, well, what I would say is I apologize. I'm sorry for all of the confusion, right? You know, one of the greatest things about the United States as well is we value our differences. We value the differences of opinions. And in some cases, we're just as frustrated as others watching some of the craziness that occurs, specifically at the political level in our country. And so one thing that I will promise you is, regardless who is in the White House, regardless who may be the so-called leader or decision maker in some cases, we will always, always aggressively, passionately, and with all of our might fight anything that blocks our role of providing educational access and educational attainment. And so in the, you know, there's been several executive orders. There's been a, you know, back and forth on the SEVP announcements and rescissions and things. What I can say is ASU was at the front foot of that immediately. You may not have seen us, or, you know, we weren't the first to be in the newspaper, you know, challenging the, but we like to do a lot of our stuff behind the scenes, right? We have relationships in Washington, D.C. We have relationships across the world that we leverage, and they heard from us immediately. We have been active, and in fact, our president has written, whether it be op-eds, and we're even considering placing, our president placing videos and other medium in India explaining what we do in this regard. But we are fearless of fighting for what we believe in, and that's educational access and attainment. And we will not back down from anyone who is trying to change that. Every announcement, every executive order that has occurred recently didn't impact our students. So the SEVP announcement that said, you know, you can't attend if you are at a school that's 100% online. Well, we're not offering 100% online. We have multiple ways that students can provide or can get an education at ASU. We were one of the first schools to be able to bring in technology to ensure that when COVID hit America in March, mid-March, when we had to close our campus, that things didn't stop. They just moved into a different phase, if you will. But we also are not afraid to say, okay, well, we're going to just change and we're going to move into a different type of educational experience. And because we have partnerships and relationships across the world, we can move on a dime.
Matt, thank you. It's so nice to see that you are such a passionate advocate for access to education. Now, talking about access to education, you mentioned a little bit about technology already, but how is ASU using technology in these times to help students remain connected? Could you talk a little bit about what does that look like for your university?
Well, I mean, we're using a platform called Zoom right now, right? Well, I've actually been using Zoom, and ASU has been using Zoom for several years now. And I have staff that are actually based out of India and China and across the world. And I've been communicating. I have more recruiters, if you will, who live outside of Arizona than who live in Arizona. And so we've been using Zoom, you know, just in my office, and we've been using Zoom in our classrooms for a while. In fact, we've been such a big promoter and user of Zoom. Zoom has recently announced that they're opening an office just down the street from the Tempe campus to partner with ASU on that. So the other thing I would say is we have a long history of using technologies, like I had mentioned. And so, you know, we have courses that utilize augmented reality and virtual reality. We have courses that there are people if you, you know, there are so many jobs out there that I'm not even aware of, but we actually have dozens of people who their job is essentially course design. So it's not being the expert of what the subject matter is, but it's to assist the faculty in being able to deliver that course utilizing technology in a way that enhances the experience. In addition, COVID has created a new modality for us, and that's what we call ASU Sync. And what ASU Sync is, if we were watching this live, this would be an ASU Sync session where we have professors who are literally in a classroom teaching, and they have people physically in front of them learning, but they also have people joining them in a digital fashion. And so we have, of the almost 1,000 classrooms at ASU, we have spent millions of US dollars upgrading our classrooms so that they have video capabilities, they have recording capabilities, they have microphones in the ceilings and the walls. They have, so that, you know, those joining in an ASU Sync capacity can literally interact and ask questions and hear what their fellow students are saying in the classroom, right? And so we think that this is a new, kind of a new frontier, and we've been innovating in that regard. This is not very technologically advanced, but it's important. We also wanted our students, and many of our students will start from their home country for many reasons. They can't leave. It's super expensive right now because very few airlines are flying. They haven't been able to get visa yet, etc. But we don't want, again, we don't want that to interrupt their educational aspirations. And so I've worked with our faculty and many of our academic leaders to see if we could offer courses that are time zone friendly for, say, India and South Asia. And so we have many faculty who will be teaching classes this fall in a convenient time zone for our students in India. You know, it could be 10 p.m. Arizona time, but it's 10:30 in the morning for a student in Mumbai who's taking, you know, thermodynamics or whatever it may be, okay? And so we utilize technology.
Matt, wanted to know, since a lot of students will be listening to you right now, but what about OPT? What about CPT? Is it staying? Is it going away? You know, what is happening there, and how does ASU facilitate this, if at all?
Yeah, well, right now, nothing's changed, right? So I think that's the most important piece, that OPT, STEM OPT, CPT is an important part of the educational journey with ASU, and we realize that. But again, we're not one to allow others to decide what type of educational experience students will have. And so we're working with, you know, if for some reason OPT changes or is stalled for a little while.
And thank you. I'm sure that's very reassuring to people who are listening today. Now, how is ASU preparing to welcome students back to campus also? Because eventually, you know, the online mode may move to hybrid or fully in person. So how specifically is the university preparing to welcome everybody back?
Yeah, well, the first thing we've done, in fact, we've even partnered with you and IDP and many of our other educational partners, is we knew immediately, and this was all the way back in March, that there would be some uncertainty on whether or not students would be able to come to campus, would feel comfortable coming to campus, would have the ability to come to campus, et cetera. And so we quickly, and again, one of the best things about ASU is we have staff all over the world. We quickly partnered and included our staff in country, in India specifically, in China and other places, to create in-country connections. Educational experience very much is a person-to-person or people-to-people interactions, right? education these days is very collaborative, right? And so we know and we promise our students that even though you might have to start in this ASU sync modality while you're studying it at home and until you can travel to the United States or to Tempe or Arizona, we knew that being able to have some in-country programs, in-country contacts, even if it was just simply of having a phone number and somebody answering it during the day in India, was very important. We knew that we'd need to provide possibly some technology support. Students being able to learn how to use our learning management system that's called Canvas to be able to interact and figure out how they're able to log into their classes if they're having Zoom challenges or whatnot. We knew it would be important to have real-time live people in country there to assist. So we have quickly spun up, and we are in very short order about to announce all of those opportunities as the fall semester begins with us on the 20th of August, just 2 weeks away, really. And we have all sorts of sessions and opportunities for them to meet their faculty and learn from other students. So we've created a lot of in-country opportunities, I guess is what I would say.
So Matt, related to this, students often wonder about internships that are offered by universities. You know, are they paid? Are they unpaid? You know, are they only available for master's students? What about undergraduate students? So how do internships work at your university? Does it vary course to course? Is a student kind of left on their own to find something? Or how do you assist? If you could speak to us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so, I'm actually going to utilize a larger theme, and that's just how can they have practical experience while they're a student, right? Internships are certainly practical, but I think in some instances there are other opportunities that students could have as well. I actually employ many international students, and so even though I don't call it an internship, they're being paid to work with admission services as ambassadors to recruitment activities, to mentoring prospective students, et cetera, et cetera. And so I'm gonna be inclusive of those type of opportunities as well, because I think that's an important piece. The most important thing that I would say is falls back again on those success metrics that we're all are accountable to, right? And so if I'm accountable to ensuring that students have great career opportunities, connection to their careers, practical experience, there are definitely people on our campus whose job it is to create those paths. Again, whether it's with some of our partners like Infosys, Zoom. As Zoom comes in, I guarantee you our president has already talked to them and has said something to the effect of, if you're going to bring Zoom to Phoenix, you better hire our students and you better give our students opportunities to be a part of the fabric of your corporation. And ASU has such a strong reputation and such a strong history of bringing and connecting with students that are so incredible that corporations are just, they want to work with us. They are going to be creative with us. They want to be a part of those things. And like I said, we're about to announce some new partnerships with some very key and I think important South Asia corporations, I should say not new partnerships, but expanded partners. They've always been incredible partners with us. And so, whether it be our career service office that is helping students find these internships, some are paid, some are credit-based, you'll earn university credit for doing them. whether it's connecting them to job opportunities. So it may not be a formal internship, but it's a, hey, you know, this office or this faculty member actually pays students. You know, if I even, I, again, one of the, I hire master's students. I hire, I should say graduate or postgraduate students from our data analytics program to help me with building reports and analytics and, you know, some of those things that I feel is important that we build into the fabric of our work. And I'm utilizing current students. And so I'm going to WP Carey, which is our business school, one of the best business schools, largest business schools in the world. And I'm working with their data analytics students, and I'm working with the engineering students to design new processes as in many instances. Or I'm going to our Herberger Institute and working with the School of Design, which actually there's a lot of South Asians studying design. And I'm having them help construct maybe a virtual campus tour could be created. And so again, there are lots of opportunities. I mean, we are a large enterprise. Like I said, on our way to 200,000 students, tens of thousands of employees who work for this enterprise. And, you know, we have Innovation Accelerator. And so, in fact, many of some of our international alumni have actually started businesses out of our accelerator as students. And then once they've graduated, we help them actually incorporate and build business plans and get off their on their way to having, you know, those wonderful opportunities. So I guess the moral of the story is we have people to ensure that those success metrics are achieved by our students.
Matt, thank you so much. I think listening to all of your insights will definitely clear a lot of doubts people might be having in their mind. And it's very clear that you, ASU as a whole institution, you know, are very kind of driven and passionate about the students, the student experience. And as you said, also the success outcomes, like by getting a degree at ASU, what is your outcome? How can you move ahead in life and go ahead and be even more successful with what you've learned here at the institution? So, you know, in closing, Matt, what would you, you know, like to share with students and parents and others who might be unsure about, you know, whether they want to take that step? You know, what challenges, you know, perhaps should they be ready to face in what we are calling this new normal, and what will help them become successful moving forward?
Yeah. You know, I don't know if the new normal has been defined yet, but I think what, at least what I predict, is that I think education is going to look a little different, right? And although it may not look a little different for ASU, it's going to look a lot different than what maybe your students think traditional American experience is going to look like, right? ASU students are already utilizing and having the benefit of all the technology that we have, right? And I know other universities are scrambling to quickly bring in a lot of those same technologies that I've mentioned. So I think students need and families need to be comfortable that the educational delivery, the educational experience is going to look a little bit different, right? In many instances, many universities have been built around people congregating and being in large numbers, large lecture halls and large classrooms and American football games, right? And that's all going to be very different. We're going to have to look, you know, class sizes could be much smaller for many years to come. The interpersonal relationships that typically form might look a little bit different. I think they're going to actually be even stronger. I have found that I've been able to connect with lots more people than I ever have been. Been doing this 20 years, and I've met more people abroad because of this virtual opportunity to connect like we're doing right now than I have in probably 20 years combined, right? And so I guess what I'm going to say is I think we all are can expect that it's going to look a little bit differently. I think, however, and again, I told you I like challenges. I see these as wonderful opportunities. I see these as that our current challenges could completely revolutionize and improve education across the world. I think the fact that countries are warming up to the idea of online education, and we're going to hold those that become online education providers accountable, and we're going to allow those who have been successful in online education to lead the way and kind of show those best practices. That is a tremendously exciting time for a guy whose job is to provide access to education. I now have the world at my fingertips if online education becomes a recognized and reputable educational delivery system. My goals no longer go from having 200,000 students, don't tell my president I said this, but maybe 1 million, who knows, right? I only don't want the president to know that because he's probably already set that goal for me and I just haven't heard it yet. But the idea is education is going to be different. It's going to be better. Guarantee you that. The faculty members who have had to learn how to teach through this current challenge are going to be better faculty members. They're going to be more receptive to utilizing the technologies that I've said. They're going to be more receptive to allowing students to be involved more. They're going to have to think through, okay, if half my class is, you know, in countries outside of the United States, I'm going to have to change the way I do this course, and I'm hoping to make it more interpersonal or personal. And so that's going to be it. Now, students are going to have to be probably a little bit more disciplined, right? You might not have that instructor to go down the hall and pull you out of your residence hall room and say, we got to go to class. Right? There are lots of distractions in when you use technology, right? I mean, here I am now with my email up and I got my Slack up and I'm getting text messages and all of those things all while we're doing this webinar, right? And so those distractions could potentially be challenging. But I think one of the greatest things about American education is it's always been built on adapting. And this just highlights the need that more people are probably going to have to adapt quicker than normal. And, you know, we find ourselves at ASU as being the leader in this, and we take that responsibility. We're very humble with that responsibility. We recognize that it's an incredible honor to have that responsibility, and we take it very seriously, and we're excited about it.
Well, Matt, thank you so much for your time with us today, and I would say we wish you 1 million students in your near future. So we hope the president is listening or not listening to that. But again, thank you so much for your time and all of your wonderful insights and, you know, the passion with which you have spoken about access to education and education in the US and specifically at ASU. I think it's been very motivating, and I do hope it instills confidence in many of our viewers today. So Yukti, having said that, I'm going to hand it back over to you so we can close out today's episode.
Thank you, Dharma. Thank you so much, Matt, for being with us and, of course, ensuring students in South Asia, that your university is there to support them in every aspect. So everyone, this brings us to the end of the episode. And before we end, just a brief on how IDP can assist achieve your dream to study in the US. We would want to inform you that we have opened 41 virtual offices so that we can get connected with you at the comfort from your home. We would be able to assist you through the admission process for US university, help you shortlist universities depending on your budget, program, and profile. We will be able to provide you information on scholarship, entry requirements, and financial aid that could be given to you by US university, help you give you information about application fee waivers, help you edit your statement of purpose, letters of recommendation, and also help you understand the financial documents which would be required for you to get acceptance from your US universities. At the end, help you with your visa counseling, as well as help you prepare for your visa interview. So also, we would ask you to mark your calendars for our second USA virtual fair, which is starting on 4th September until end of September. We will have various universities participating from all over US, and you can connect with them one-on-one virtually. So keep watching IDP social medias for more update and information and to know how to register. Thank you all from myself and Dharma, and thank you for watching this.